The following program is a satirical look at Indigenous news, politics, and current events. Reconciliation is advised.
Anine Bourgeois, welcome to The Laughing Drum, television so deeply and profoundly Indigenous, we have our own comprehensive land claim. I am your host, Tim Fontaine, back for another season of whatever this show is supposed to be. But before we move on to a new season, we thought we should take a look back at the last one. Because if there's one thing our elders teach us, it's that we should always look to the past before moving forward. Also, I've been asleep for the past 6 months and never got around to booking any guests. I feel shame. But I am also flooded with memories. In fact, I remember The Laughing Drum like it was just last year, a year when this show tackled some of the biggest issues facing Indigenous people today, like reconciliation.
Dad, what's reconciliation?
Well, son, in Canada, reconciliation is a little complicated.
How so?
Imagine someone stole your bike. How would that make you feel?
Oh, that'd be awful.
Okay, now imagine that person who stole your bike, they apologized. How would that make you feel?
Better, I guess. Would I get my bike back?
No, they still need your bike. So now they ride by your house every day and they apologize. That, my son, is reconciliation in Canada. You understand?
I guess so.
Hey. Enough with the lip. You'll get a taste of the belt. Now, go along. Play with your friends.
I don't know about you, but I feel at least 20% more reconciled just watching that. 2018 was also the year that I realized that no amount of canned meat is ever enough. I can still taste that sandwich. In 2018, we never kept our eyes off the political intrigue and drama at the Assembly of First Nations.
Mm-hmm.
that wasn't exciting enough for you, the Laughing Drum even showed you just how sexy the job of National Chief can be. Last year, we even embedded ourselves into all of the action at the 2018 AFN election.
Whereas we are in Vancouver, where in just a few short hours, chiefs who have gathered here, 600 chiefs who have gathered here, will soon choose a new national leader. So what is the Assembly of First Nations, you ask? Well, to help you get up to speed, we've created this, AFN 101. Check it out.
The Assembly of First Nations is a political organization representing First Nations communities from coast to coast. The modern Assembly of First Nations was born as the National Indian Brotherhood in the 1960s. That group rose to prominence in 1969 when it organized nationally to fight against the White Paper, a policy that was proposed by then Prime Minister Pierre Trudeau. Yes, that's current Prime Minister Justin Trudeau's daddy. The White Paper would have abolished all treaties and rights, making First Nations just plain old boring Canadians, which is a pretty douchey move. The feds eventually backed down, but the National Indian Brotherhood was here to stay. By the 1980s, the group changed its name to the Assembly of First Nations. Since then, the AFN has emerged as arguably the most vocal, visible, and influential First Nations political entity in the country. We said arguably. So how does it work? The group is headed by the National Chief, who is typically elected every 3 years in a fierce battle to the death. Okay, maybe we're kidding about the death battle. They actually just choose the leader in a vote. The AFN also has an executive committee made up of 10 regional chiefs from across the country. The national chief and the executive committee get their marching orders in the form of resolutions that are tabled and voted on during two assemblies each year, usually. But while it sounds like the AFN is a government, it is not. It may be modeled on the United Nations General Assembly, but the Assembly of First Nations is a lobby group for chiefs. And only chiefs can vote for National Chief, who is not actually a chief, but a national spokesperson. Even the AFN's charter states that, quote, the National Chief shall have no inherent political power, unquote.
Any political power is supposed to be held by the over 630 chiefs that make up the AFN.
Yeah, well, I'm embedded, right? So this is dangerous territory right now. Lots of politics flying around. You never know what's going to happen. So I figured better safe than sorry. You know what I mean? All right, thank you. Perry! No, all right, well, let's keep going. And who can forget our non-award-winning coverage of Parliament Hill? I know I can't. I've tried.
You like Canadian politics? Sure you do. Well, then you probably already know that in the 2015 federal election, a record number of Indigenous members of Parliament were elected, and they've been making political history ever since. Remember when NDP MP Romeo Saganash called for Conservative Senator Lynn Bayek to resign? Or Jody Wilson-Raybould's impassioned speech at the United Nations?
Reconciliation requires laws to change and policies to be rewritten.
And who can forget the time Robert Falcon Ouellette spoke out against his own party's stance on medically assisted dying?
I don't believe at this time that that we have taken into full consideration the implications.
Well, now you can relive all this exciting action anytime you want with finger puppets. We've got Jody Wilson-Raybould, Hunter Tutu, Robert Falcon Ouellette, Romeo Saganash, Don Rustak, Yvonne Jones, Georgina Jollibois, Dan Vandell, Michael McLeod, and this guy. Make some history of your own.
I'll be the best prime minister ever!
Go to aptn.ca/laughingdrum to download your own finger puppets today.
And speaking of Parliament, remember how the Laughing Drum covered the splitting of Indigenous Affairs into two departments? Because I don't. To be alive. We have to take a short break, but when we come back, we'll walk down memory lane some more and take a look at some of the memorable guests we had on the show last season. Don't even think about going away. Welcome back to The Laughing Drum, where our pop cultural references end somewhere around 1986. If you are just joining us, we're getting warmed up for an all-new season of The Laughing Drum by looking back at the last season, including some of the amazing guests we've had the privilege of interviewing, like these Indigenous musicians.
Your music is pretty unique. It's like a mix of hip-hop, country, there's some spoken word in there. Where does that sound come from?
I think it comes from, like, just... It's almost like a playlist for a res party, you know? I grew up listening to a lot of country music with my parents, and then my brother was of the age when, like, Dr. Dre and Snoop Dogg and all of this, like, G-Funk era hip-hop was coming out, so I started listening to a little bit of that. And then as I started to develop my own musical tastes, I started listening to hip-hop and country and, you know, all of these other different influences, so it kind of felt natural when I started learning how to play guitar to put hip-hop lyrics over top of that, and then to sing hooks and stuff like that. So yeah, it's been a natural development just over time. Like, you know, every you know, you probably have some burned CDs and, mixtapes where, like, Hank Williams and Ice Cube, you know?
All guests on my show receive a can of the Laughing Drum canned luncheon meat.
I want to give
this
you,
is for you. Oh my,
a piece of bannock.
Look at this. This is incredible.
It's your own recipe.
Look at that. Look at that. If ever there was a match made in Nietzsche heaven, here it is right here. Look, it's almost like it's smiling. Look.
Cue the love song.
The Laughing Drum also always makes time for Indigenous authors.
Okay, one last question, and this is a very serious one.
Shoot.
Who would win in a fight, a sockeye salmon or a pickerel?
Easily sockeye. Easily.
Those are fighting words, I think.
And of course, we talk politics a lot on this show. If it was going by largest headdress, who do you think would win?
I'm not sure. I haven't seen all their headdresses.
You haven't measured all their headdresses?
No, I haven't.
Is that something you look for?
No.
No? Why not?
I don't know if that's something
Isn't that impressive? Yeah.
Yeah, they're nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. Ribbon shirts, bolo ties, you know?
Let's see, dresses.
Yes,
see, yeah.
What's the biggest political scandal you've ever covered up?
The biggest one I have ever covered up would probably be my parking pass at work. Yeah, I ain't paying that $5 a day, man. That's a year's treaty money every day. So I figured out how the parking works, so I've been able to get in and out for free downtown Ottawa. That's like, what, I should be a millionaire by now, right?
I think it's dinner time for chiefs now.
Gray smoke, we have a new national chief. There you go. I didn't know we were going so long here.
And regardless of the guest, we are never afraid to ask the tough questions.
Are you familiar with Billy Jack? Billy Jack was a 1970s indigenous actor. He wore a black cowboy hat, and he would take his boots off, and he would roundhouse kick bad guys. That was his whole thing. If you could time travel and you could transform yourself into Billy Jack, who would you time travel Billy Jack roundhouse to the face? Which historical figure?
Oh my goodness. Maybe Perry Belgar? Does he count as historical?
How We Have Never Been Sued is truly one of the creator's great mysteries. We have to take a short break, but when we come back, we'll take a look back at some of my favorite moments with TV's greatest team, the Red Power Panel. Fix yourself some tea and bannock and come right back. Welcome back to the third and final portion of our look back at the Laughing Drum's 2018 season. Now, you've probably noticed that political panels are a staple of television shows these days. But while those other networks have their at-issue panels or their power panels or their whites-only panels, we're the only network brave enough to have the Red Power Panel. It's a television panel so deeply Indigenous they are recognized as an independent First Nation community by the AFN. And almost every week last season, they were ready to take the country's hottest topics and tear them to pieces like a hungry crow. Sorry, we start in South Africa, where that country's parliament has voted to seize land from white farmers without compensation. It's meant to end the disparities in land ownership that remain since apartheid ended. Your first thoughts on this? We'll start with you, Alyssa.
Great. Super. I think... Am I supposed to not feel happy about this?
I don't know.
Hooray! Congratulations.
Leonard, what about you?
Welcome to the club.
All right, let's get serious here for a second.
That wasn't serious. Yeah. Let's move on to something even more serious.
Let's say you all had magic powers.
Oh.
All right. Mm. Some kind of magic, and you could compel the Pope and the Vatican to do something to atone for residential schools. What would that be? What would you use your magic powers for? Nelson, let's start with you.
Oh, I have no idea where to go with that one. if I can make the Pope do something, I would like them to put Jesus in the Offspring Pretty Fly for a White Guy video, because I think you're claiming that he's white anyway. Let's own it. Go all out. I want to see Jesus in that video. I don't know what it does for restitution. I just want to see it happen. You gave me magical powers. Let's go there.
Yeah. Sasha?
I change his outfit. It's horrible. That's a sin. That's a big problem. That's where we should start. It looks like he got dressed at Bed Bath & Beyond. It's not okay.
Suddenly we're on Queer Eye for the Pope guy.
I was thinking we should have some sort of a papal powwow.
Yeah?
Yeah, right there in the Vatican City. I don't know. I mean, some of our leaders have been over there, but why not a powwow? How about a round dance around the...
I could see the Pope round dancing.
Yeah. I don't know about that. I think a powwow there would be something to see.
Incredible stuff. I don't know about you, but I smell a Canadian Screen Award. It smells a little like fresh bannock. But unlike those other TV panels, the Red Power Panel is also unafraid to show some of their non-punditry skills, like in this now infamous segment. All right, welcome back to the Laughing Drum. Now, you know, if there's one thing Indigenous peoples are good at, it's pointing with our lips.
Yes, pointing with your lips is something of an Olympic-level sport in some communities, and now it's going to grace your screens thanks to the Red Power panel. We're going to play a little game I like to call the Lip-Pointing Olympics. Are we ready?
Yeah.
Are your lips ready? All right. So here's the object of the game. Beside me is my good friend Wilfred Moore. He's going to be the assistant today. The Red Power panel is going to stand on this side of the desk. They're going to point at one of these items here. Wilfred's job is to pick the one that they're pointing at with their lips. So you have to be very accurate with your lip pointing in order for Wilfred to get it. So let's start with Sasha Mark.
Okay.
All right. Now, Sasha has picked an item that only I know.
Mm-hmm. Is my mustache a disadvantage?
Okay. You know what? It could be an advantage. I don't know, because it almost looks like it's aiming, right?
Okay.
So, point at your item, Wilfred. Sasha Mark has chosen the Commander Chakotay action figure. Can Wilfred figure it out? And will Sasha's mustache be a help or a hindrance? Let's see.
Yay!
Oh my God, he got it!
I did it!
Okay. That is some very, very, very accurate lip pointing there.
That's
Commander
Chakotay.
No, he doesn't win it, unfortunately. Jerry, get your lips up there.
Oh, all right.
All right. Now, Jerry Barrett is a master lip pointer. He's going to point at an item. Oh, look at that. Now, I hope you're not lip point doping here, but.
It's cheating.
You
have an advantage.
All right, get ready. Wilfred, you ready? Jerry Barrett has chosen the Ernest Munia CD. As you can see, he has really perfected his lip pointing technique, and he employs a lip balm. Very unusual.
Yes.
Whoa!
Yes.
Ernest Munias, he wins again.
All right, Ernest.
And you know what? When it's Wilfred, when it's Ernest Munias, we all win.
That's right.
True.
That's what our elders tell us. All right, Alyssa, get your lips up here. Three items left. Alyssa Kixon has chosen the Jody Wilson-Raybould finger puppet. Kixon hails from the Kuchiching First Nation in Ontario. It's known across the nation as traditional lip-pointing territory. Oh, my God! You know what? You guys are all pros. I told you. Such precision. Still gives me goosebumps. Well, that's it for our look back at everything that made the Laughing Drum tolerable last year. We hope you'll come back next week as we kick off another new season with even more fascinating guests and, of course, the Red Power panel. We'll see you then. Do you like First Nations politics? Sure you do. Yes, you do. Well then, you probably already know that the Assembly of First Nations will soon choose a new leader. Now you can play along at home with these new collecting cards from the Laughing Drum. We've got incumbent Perry Bellegarde, challengers Catherine Whitecloud, Russ Diabo, Sheila North, and this guy. We've even got classic political players like Phil Fontaine, Ovid Mercury, and Matthew Kuhnkamp. If you're lucky, you might even find this super rare Perry Bellegarde rookie card. Collect them all and trade them with your friends. You'll be glad you did. Reconciliation is advised. The Laughing Drum is not responsible for the memorandum of these brothers that are signed and playing.